Good evening, and welcome to this forum on the future of public broadcasting, sponsored by the Friends of Canadian Broadcasting. My name is Ian Morrison, and I speak for Friends. Many of you will be supporters of Friends, but some are not. Maybe you're future supporters of Friends. So first, just a little bit about the Friends of Canadian Broadcasting, the sponsor of this event. Friends is a nonpartisan watchdog for more and better Canadian content on the air and online. Friends came into being in 19... We'll never get finished by 8:30. So applaud me. I mean, you should save your hands for the
comments. Oh yeah, applaud us. That would be awesome.
Friends came into being in 1985. Since then, we have tussled with governments of all stripes when they have attacked the CBC or undermined Canadians' ability to tell our own stories. That includes the governments of Brian Mulroney, Jean Chrétien, Paul Martin, and Stephen Harper. The CBC is a popular institution. We know this from public opinion polling. Support for public broadcasting spans the political spectrum. For example, a strong majority of conservative supporters also support public broadcasting. 175,000 Canadian families support our work. Like supporters of the CBC, they come from all political backgrounds. It was, after all, a conservative prime minister, R.B. Bennett, in the depths of the Great Depression, who created what became the CBC 80 years ago. I have just arrived from Calgary this morning, where Friends hosted last night an all-candidates meeting in the Calgary Centre by-election, right in Prime Minister Harper's backyard. I can tell you, it was a great success. Support for public broadcasting and the CBC runs deep in Calgary, as it does here in Victoria. 3,250 families in this riding support Friends' work, the highest number in any riding across the country. Now, if you ask me who was number two, or which was number two, I'd have some trouble with that. Probably Quadra. For the first time this century, the CBC's plans for the future and its past performance are up for discussion at a CRTC license review that began only yesterday in Gatineau, Quebec. I will be presenting on Friends' behalf at that meeting. But regulation is only one of the forces influencing the CBC. Politics is another, which brings us to this evening. A famous political leader once said, "There are only two kinds of people who walk through my office door. There are the people who can hurt you back home. And then there's everyone else." Well, Friends' goal tonight and throughout this by-election and in the work we are doing in the other two ridings where campaigns are underway is to make sure that all of our political leaders, including the Prime Minister, understand that support for and concern about the CBC and public broadcasting are local issues back home. But, excuse me, by being here tonight, you are sending a message, that message, loud and clear. Thank you. With that, I'm looking forward to the views of the candidates. We have invited candidates representing political parties with seats in the House of Commons to participate tonight. Three of the four candidates have accepted our invitation. I've never met a politician without something to say, and so let's get underway. Here's how it will work. Off the top, each candidate will have 3 minutes to make an opening statement. Following opening statements, we will move directly to questions. If you would like to ask a question, please write it down on one of the index cards that are available. I saw some people writing them down on index cards before this. And give it to one of the volunteers who will bring it to the podium and it will be asked by on your behalf by me. It would help me if you could keep it legible. Otherwise, I'll just improvise. And you can include your name if you like. Please raise your hands, the volunteers.
Can you stand up?
Yeah, maybe you should just stand up. Yeah, so there are sufficient people here who can handle these things. The future of public broadcasting is our main topic tonight. If we exhaust all questions on public broadcasting, we will accept questions on other topics, provided there is time at the end of the meeting. Candidates will have 1 minute to respond to each question. Following the initial responses, each candidate will have 1 minute to comment on their opponent's response. It's my job to make sure that this forum wraps up in the advertised time, 8:30 on the dot. So starting in alphabetical order, I would like to introduce Green Party candidate Donald Galloway. As a law professor, Donald has championed the human rights of refugees for many years. He has taught and served as Associate Dean of Law at Queen's University in Kingston. Donald's human rights activism led to his appointment to the Immigrant and Refugee Board of Canada and to his pro bono work for Lost Canadians, an advocacy organization for those who have been denied Canadian citizenship for various reasons. Donald.
What a pleasure this is. I am so glad to see so many people out tonight. This forum on the CBC offers the candidates in the election an excellent opportunity to identify who we are and what values we hold. And I'm so glad to have an opportunity to do that. First of all, I'd like to state that the idea that there are public goods plays a major role in my political philosophy. There are matters that should not be subject to the vagaries of the marketplace.
Use the microphone.
Can you hear that?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank
very
you.
Public space.
Okay.
5 more seconds.
And there are matters that shouldn't be subject to the desires and whims of individuals or corporate entities who are seeking profit. I could list a number of public goods, many relating to our natural surroundings and to our interactions and relations with other species. But I want to identify to you two in particular that relate to culture rather than to the environment. The first is the public good of living in an open society, where we have access to information and debate about the workings of government.
Equal access.
I will be referring to this throughout the night, I hope. Democracy only flourishes in an open society. The second public good relates to the arts. We need to recognize a common space where our imaginations can flourish, where our strongest poetic voices can be heard above the noise of daily life, where our musicians can strike our deepest emotions, where visual artists can present us with images, where writers who are able to articulate the strongest and most significant aspects of the human condition are provided with the opportunities to do their work, and we are provided with appropriate vehicles to access them. We need, in other words, a space where the arts can flourish, where experiments can be initiated that show us alternative versions of who we are and who we can be. In the past, the CBC has provided and offered us this space. It has brought a seriousness to our culture, but it has also tinged it with a sense of humor that punctures any self-aggrandizing tendencies. This space is integral to our to our identity as citizens of Canada. Thank you very much.
Next up is NDP candidate Murray Rankin. Murray is a longtime resident of Victoria and a nationally recognized expert in environmental and public law. He co-chairs the Environmental Law Center at the University of Victoria, and he has a private law practice. Murray has been president of the West Coast Environmental Law Association and the BC Public Interest Advocacy Center, and currently is leading a team of legal experts working to stop the Enbridge pipeline. Murray, back to you.
Good evening. Can you hear me in the back? Great, thank you. Well, I want to tell you a phrase that really stirs me. It's one I hear and you hear often if you listen to CBC One, and it goes like this. Canada lives here. Canada lives here is an expression that really summarizes the role, the mandate of CBC, and why it's precious to us. It's about our shared experiences as Canadians. It's part of the vital glue that holds this country together. Let me be personal for a moment. I went to high school with Barbara Budd and Paul Kennedy, names that some of you may know. Paul Kennedy and I were the Niagara debating championship back, I won't tell you how long ago, we've been friends ever since, and Barbara Budd and my sister are best friends to this day. I know what it's like to work at CBC, I know the struggles that they've gone through. In the time available, I want to say a couple of very sobering things, however, about the future of this critically important institution. As you may know, Mr. James Moore is the minister responsible for heritage. The day after the last election, he said this: "We believe in the national public broadcaster. We have said that we will maintain or increase support for the CBC. That is our platform, and we've said it before, and we will commit to that." As you all know, in last year's budget, $115 million was cut. Effectively, the Friends of Canadian Broadcasting report a 16% cut. Mr. Jean Chrétien in the Red Book said back in 1993, quote, "A Liberal government will be committed to stable, multi-year financing for national cultural institutions such as the CBC." However, after they became government, the Liberals went to work on CBC and cut more than $400 million, or 33% of the budget. Canada lives here, but it lives here with difficulty, without money, the oxygen that's required to make this institution a living, breathing being. And I want to say that our goal as the NDP is to restore the stable funding that's required as job one. Thank you.
And finally, the Liberal candidate, Paul Somerville. Paul Somerville is a business professor at the University of Victoria. For 6 years, Paul was chief economist of RBC Capital and has worked in a number of prominent financial firms. Paul is well-traveled, having worked and studied in Canada, Israel, Japan, and the United States. He has written extensively on the growing gap between the rich and the poor in Canada and internationally. His top national priority is fighting income inequality and making life better for Canada's beleaguered middle class. Paul?
Thank you very much, and again, it's a real pleasure to share the dais with such great candidates. Our campaigns have been civil and I think intelligent, and I'm very grateful for that. Now, I know I'm on the same page with Murray and Don when I say how vital and important a properly funded and independent national broadcaster for Canada is, as well as regional and local public broadcasting. As Don said, the public broadcaster creates a special space for all citizens to share their ideas, stories, and passion about Canada. I have my own CBC story that I'd like to share with you. I grew up in all places, Scarborough, Ontario, which I escaped when I was 19. The first time I felt really homesick was in 1980 when I moved to Alberta. to do my master's degree in political science. Everything just felt a little weird. Then one morning I was driving somewhere and I chanced upon Morningside with Peter Zosky. He had a housewife on the phone from some unknown place in Nova Scotia. And she was saying in her own roundabout way how much she enjoyed listening to his show. Because even though the Canadians he spoke to were very different from her, they were, as she said, only different in style, not in substance. That moment has always stayed with me. But 32 years later, in the year 2012, I'm not sure that the message or the messenger is the same. Because after 6 years of the evil Harper government, our Canadian story is being rewritten without the embrace of social justice, but the justice of the market and the mythological, self-reliant individual. Like Mitt Romney and Big Bird, the Harper government is determined to make public broadcasting irrelevant to our daily lives. Liberal leader Bob Rae, interim leader, wrote about our over-privatized societies after decades of free market mayhem that jeopardizes our collective life. The public space, the school, the park, the courtroom, the library, the train station, the hospital, and the public broadcaster are vital in creating empathy among citizens because we are all equal when we share that space. The only requirement for entry is citizenship, not an introduction, not a good address, not an application form, not a big entry fee, not a college degree. The public broadcaster appeals to the innate sense of sympathy in human beings that transcends the pursuit of profit and reminds us that societies can organize themselves to favor the community over the market. I call this the invisible hand of social justice. The public broadcaster gives free rein to the invisible hand of social justice as citizens are brought together by shared experiences, like a kid, homesick for Toronto, connecting a housewife somewhere in Nova Scotia. To lose that is to lose the chance to be Canadian.
Thank you, Paul.
The new provisions of the Election Act make it an offense to control. You're making this an effect, and this is a provision of the Elections Act. Did you read it? And it says here, the right to equal access for all candidates, irrespective of their political affiliation or their views that they promote. That is in the Federal Act. You want to hear what I have to say? I've listened to CBC since a long time before you.
Then come and sit with us, because we do too.
I have something to tell you, and I am a legitimate candidate. And you are infringing on the Federal Elections Act.
You're interrupting.
And I'm going to make a complaint unless you...
My name is Ian Morrison. I speak for this organization. I rented this room. Get a lawyer and take me to court under the Federal Elections Act. And get off the stage. You're most welcome to sit down here, but you're not going to interrupt this meeting. And if necessary, we will call the police.
Do so. Please do so.
Yesterday, we have to invite
the police, and it will look very good when we have an election.
This is our space, get out!
And you can drag me off the stage. Go ahead, drag me off the stage.
Boo!
You don't think I got something to say about the CBC? The CBC is not representing the people. And you care to hear about it? That's it, that's the Election Act. Right. Who do you think? Yes, I have first class.
You have a motion.
Go ahead. Please go. Go ahead. That's great. Campbell, this is in
no,
the Election Act.
No, we would like you to go.
This is an offense. This is
you are an
offense.
Offense to us in our space here.
Maybe you've got something to learn.
Your redress, sir, is to charge me with an offense on the Elections Act. Called this meeting, we explained to everybody, including all of you, that we were inviting candidates from political parties that were represented in the House of Commons.
And you have a right
not to any other. And we are going
what
to continue
kind of a
with
democracy
our meeting.
Will you predetermine the result by who you act? What kind of a democracy is that? Is this free speech with free
opportunity?
You've
taken more than 3 minutes already, sir.
Can this gentleman ask a question?
And you've been talking.
Can you ask a question?
But like anybody else, he writes it.
Sir, I have as much right as anybody on this platform to speak.
You have no right to disrupt his meetings.
If that's what it takes to be democratic, I will be democratic. Go ahead, drag me. Go ahead. They're going to drag me off the stage. Drag me off the stage. Come on, you don't have the guts.
I can't overrule the candidates. They want to let him speak.
Yes. He's already had his
arguments. At least we have a few lawyers here.
Are you going to respect other rules? Or are you?
Of course I
am. How long will you speak?
For whatever time you're going to give me.
Then I'll make a deal with you. If you speak
no
for... Well, then, there's no point.
They invited me to speak, did they? These are gentlemen, and you are not.
Hey. Everybody else is respecting the rules.
2 minutes.
Hold on. He doesn't know the rules, right? So explain it for a
minute. And then you leave the stage. And I will.
Well,
this is just.
If less I'm treated equally, I am not going to do anything.
Well, I'm sorry if some of you don't approve, but.
Right? And then we'll take just make sure serious.
So,
take your 3 minutes and then.
He's already had 3 minutes.
I get 3 minutes.
3 minutes.
That's what the law says. Yeah, I'll take 3 minutes, but I'll be here for the rest of the two. Thank you, Paul. Thank you. See, you still understand democracy better than other people. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Dr. Philip May. I have done a lot for this community. I've been on the school board. I've been on the council for Promotion College. I've got SALTs going, HERTs going, Autistic Society. I deserve a right to speak. My grandfather inaugurated and was first president of the Canadian Bar Association. I had two great grandfathers in McDonald's first cabinet. And that gives me some right to speak. But apart from that, it says here in the Election Act, the right of access exists equally to all the candidates, irrespective of their political affiliation or their view of privilege. I was listening to CBC long before you were. Do you remember Jake and the Kid?
Yeah.
Do you remember Foster Hewitt?
Yeah.
I was there.
Yeah.
And I support CBC if it's objective. But it hasn't been objective and has lost a great deal of its Canadian constituency. And the way you're going to restore CBC is to get it back to being objective. And there needs to be a college of the media, like there's a college of physicians and surgeons, to which I belong. And there's a college of teachers, because they have a very important role in forming an opinion. They don't just report, they form opinions. And there needs to be a college, which is a self-regulating body that controls the media and helps them to maintain objectivity, which the CBC does not, at this time, represent. There are globalists in this audience that do not want me to speak, because I'm not part of that movement. But ladies and gentlemen, I have been here, and I have served this community, and I have listened to CBC, and I support CBC, because there should be an objective media, and that's what it was when it first began. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
I was counting on Mr. Gann's seat, but I can stand for an hour and a half. The first question is as follows. In spite of their 2011 election promise to maintain or increase CBC funding, the federal government cut the CBC's grant by $115 million in last year's budget. Yesterday in Gatineau, Quebec, the CRTC began its review of CBC's network licenses. CBC is asking for permission to place unlimited ads on CBC Radio 2 and the French language counterpart Espace Musique. Do you support ads on CBC Radio? Murray, you're first. Yep. 1 minute each.
Uh-oh, 57 seconds.
They're nicking.
I feel CBC's pain. The question is, do I support ads on Radio 2? I fear that that will only lead to ads on Radio 1. That frightens me and saddens me. But if I were CBC and I just lost $115 million, I would try to do whatever I could to support a future for the CBC, because the government is not supporting a future for the CBC. Seven conservative MPs have recently claimed that we should entirely, quote, defund the CBC. In fact, the candidate for the Conservatives in the current Calgary by-election has claimed that CBC is, quote, a purveyor of porn, if you could believe it. And I happen to think that this is appalling when people like Rob Anders say, a member for Calgary West, that, quote, we live in a 1,000-channel universe, why spend over $1 billion on a state broadcaster that's competing with the private sector? Priorities are different, values are different than those that I share.
Well, once again, you'll find, I think, at least among three of the candidates sitting up here today, a lot of agreement about the need to have a well-funded public broadcaster. The question, and I'm not an expert on how public broadcasters fund themselves, I've got a few ideas that I'd be happy to share with later. The truth is that the media business has changed so dramatically, really in a heartbeat, because of the invention of new social media. My fear is that the CBC will become more like private stations. And I can understand the instinct, the survival instinct of people who support the CBC and the CBC itself who might advocate for advertising. But I think we need a better solution. I wouldn't favor advertising. I think instead we need to think long and hard about sustainable funding for our public broadcaster, because it's such an important part of our Canadian voice. Thank you.
I started off by talking about public goods, and I tried to distinguish between public goods and goods which are traded on the market. And I think that to include commercials, to include advertisements within our cultural milieu is to debase them and to demean them. We just don't want to hear them. But that, of course, leaves the big question, which is, how are we actually going to fund what is really dear to us? How are we going to fund the arts? The answer is, that's what we pay taxes for. That is what we contribute to society for. The arts are an essential part of what we pay for. They are a critical part of the public good. Instead of just voicing our support for non-commercials, I think that what we have to do is have an effective opposition that actually identifies that clearly. We haven't had such an opposition.
My confreres are good people, and I appreciate them allowing me to speak. But each of them are for more funding, when the debt has just increased by $85 billion. And that is a debt that goes to your children and grandchildren. Do you want that for your children and grandchildren? There is no way to pay that off. And you are in the gray bracket, and you are going to soon have to sell your home to pay for your taxes. The facts of the matter are, there can be public broadcasting without advertising like they do in the Americans. They have funding. They have grants, private grants, that they don't have. You don't have to have either more government funding or advertising. There are other legitimate ways, and that's what we should pursue.
Now, the plan that we have is to enable each of the candidates to comment on the comments of the other candidates, if they wish. So first, Murray.
Well, I'm going to do this very quickly from my seat, if I may. I just read that the of the four of the 26 Western democracies, Canada spends the fourth least per capita on public broadcasting. And I think that is a demonstration of our of very different priorities. I think most people in this room would agree that that the public broadcasting, the CBC, is a national institution. It's a national gem, and we're starving it to death. And so, therefore, I think we should step up with stable, secure funding to a limit that the Heritage Committee of the House of Commons recommended, that the core funding be increased to an amount equivalent to at least half of what most Western democracies invest. It costs, that increase would amount to 1.8 cents a day for each Canadian. Is it worth paying that? I say yes.
Paul is surrendering his time in the interests of the meeting. Donald? You're most welcome to do this when I'm sitting down.
It's easier to breathe standing up.
I think that the idea of stable, secure funding is the right one. But you actually have to have effective politicians to push for it. I just ask you one question. Which politician in Parliament has pushed strongest, hardest, most tenaciously for the arts? It's Elizabeth May. It is clearly Elizabeth May. She has a petition before Parliament at the moment. You're welcome to sign it. It's outside. She is the most popular politician because she voices our needs. She has asked me to join her because she needs two voices to push in that direction. Thank you.
Here comes another question. The leaders of most national public broadcasters in Western democracies.
Excuse me, sir. I'd like to respond to the other two. It's all right to say more funding, but you notice nobody said where that money is going to come from. And so you have to think, it's got to be taxes. Do you really want more taxes?
Yes.
More taxes.
Yes. We want the CBC.
You don't have to have more taxes to have the CBC. There are other ways, like the Americans do, with private foundations. And that's a way better way to do it, because then you don't have government interference.
And as I was saying, the next question is, the leaders of most national public broadcasters in Western democracies are chosen on a merit principle. In Canada, CBC's president and its board of directors are appointed through prime ministerial patronage. The House of Commons Heritage Committee has recommended that CBC's board be appointed at arm's length from patronage, and that the board be given the power to hire and fire CBC's president. Do you favor this recommendation? And the order now will start with Donald Galloway.
When I was being introduced by Ian, he identified that I worked for the Immigration and Refugee Board for 3 years. The Governor and Council appointments to the Immigration and Refugee Board are usually based upon patronage. Patronage is killing the Immigration and Refugee Board because unqualified people are being hired to make life and death decisions. Patronage works in exactly the same way when it is being applied into the CBC. We need merit. We need people who have not the people who have just failed in elections, but we need individuals who have actually shown themselves to be contributors to the values that the CBC represents. Patronage is a scourge on our society and our government. We really need to take a public stand against it. Thank you.
I agree with Donald. It is a scourge. And let me tell you what the facts are in the current board with Prime Minister Harper's patronage appointments. Apparently, the current chair is Remy Racine, a former conservative staffer. to the CBC board chair, and it appears that essentially 8 of the 11 members of the board of directors have been shown to make financial contributions to the Conservative Party. So it seems to me it should be called the Conservative Broadcasting Corporation in recognition of the facts of life. I think it's appalling that we would allow this to occur in Canada. We need arm's length appointment processes the way that judges are appointed so that we have the ability to make sure that a list of people are provided and the Prime Minister chooses from among that list. That would be fair. That's how judges are appointed. We have lots of precedents for that. Let's get on with it.
Now, Don may have broken the gentleman's agreement that we weren't going to be too partisan. And I certainly have a lot of respect for Elizabeth May, as I think we all do. But I think the Liberal Party of Canada has shown through its history, since it, of course, was the party that established the CBC in the first place, that is profoundly committed to the voice of public broadcasting in Canadian lives. The key thing about funding and ownership and control is that people who understand how the business works should be the ones who are making the big strategic decisions and running the organization on a day-to-day basis. In my own professional life, I ran a number of businesses, and I really can't imagine someone being appointed who didn't know what they were doing. So I certainly echo the comments of Don and Murray. The patronage doesn't work, and then anything that makes the leadership around the CBC more objective and fundamentally guaranteeing the strong voice of a public broadcaster in Canada is what we need. Thank you.
If elected, I will make it possible to have a College of the Media, and the people in the media can put forward their recommendations. And that's how we operate in the College of Physicians and Surgeons, and that's how it should be. I'm well familiar with university politics. I've been full professor, department head. I have taught in 5 universities in different parts of this world. And there is a process that is well into are thinking about how appointments are made. The problem, of course, is you have one party saying the other one is into the pork barrel. They all are.
We could have, there are a lot of questions coming up, and you asked me to accommodate something earlier. I'm just gonna ask you, could we abandon this business of commenting on each other's comments? It seems to be less partisan in Victoria. I mean, last night in Calgary, partisan was spelled with a capital P. Is that okay?
We're friendly in Victoria.
Okay.
I would like to be a little contentious.
Okay. Because something was said about
I don't think that the... I don't think that the proper model is a judicial model. Because judges get something that lawyers call judgeitis. And they get judgeitis because they're given tenure. We actually want people who don't overstay their welcome when they're running an organization as important as the CBC. We want to be able to hold them to account without any notion that they hold their position until the age of 75 or until they commit some grievous wrongdoing. I think the right one is to actually base the decision upon merit and continued merit. We need oversight of all our government officials. Thank you.
Ian, can I just say one sentence?
Yeah.
The Conservatives created the CBC.
Yes.
Prime Minister R.B. Bennett, last time I knew, was a Conservative. And in 1932, public broadcasting started in Canada. Give credit where credit is due.
Yes. The Conservative Broadcasting Corporation.
Still, it was then and it still is.
Reminds me of, I heard Mulroney give a speech long after he left power, and he went through and he talked about all the wonderful things he'd done. And then he pointed at Michael Wilson, the Minister of Finance, in the audience. He said, but Michael Wilson is responsible for the GST. Now, just to move us forward a little bit, those of you who have composed these questions, as opposed to the questions that were pre-composed to get us started, we'll understand that I'm actually combining two questions. I think it might work. How important do you feel the CBC is in as a unifying influence in the country? That's the first part. And the second, what is your favorite CBC radio program? And why? Oh. Do you want to go first?
The question depends on certain assumptions, of course. And there's no question that the CBC is unifying because it implants certain attitudes, much more than you realize. I am both psychiatrist and psychologist, and I know a lot about subliminal infiltration and education. And more than you realize, you are having ideas implanted in your thinking, and then you echo them in, shall I say, rote fashion. The fact of the matter is, of course, we need a public broadcasting corporation. And what is my favorite one? Well, I'm still kind of into hockey.
The last sequence we had Galloway first, so this time it's Rankin, Somerville, then Galloway.
CBC is a vital glue to hold the country together. It's one of our major institutions. The Broadcasting Act talks about that in Section 3 as the policy core of the CBC. It's critical. It's served that function very well. I only fear that the amount of money they have to do it is decreasing to such a degree that I quite frankly worry about its ability to do that. Listening to a program like Republic of Doyle, which isn't my favorite, I'll come to it later, and hearing what's going on in Newfoundland is something that people in Victoria can laugh at the jokes that come out of that little mosque in the prairie. We could go on and on. So it's clearly helping us understand each other, explaining our realities to each other across the country. And I think that's what is really quite wonderful about the CBC. And I should say a plug for Radio Canada as well. My favorite music on CBC is invariably the jazz station on Radio Canada, but leaving that aside, my favorite program is perhaps self-interestedly CBC Ideas. I say that for two reasons. I don't get to say it. I've done two documentaries on it, one on freedom of information and one on hazardous substances, and I care a lot about that program.
I was just going to fill in for you. Ideas is a great great show, and I'm trying to sound like Paul Kennedy now.
Good luck.
La 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 la. And cross country checkup.
Yeah.
Every summer I go to Nova Scotia. About 30 or 40 years ago, my wife built a house with hand tools there, and so we still go every year. And the CBC is different in Nova Scotia. And that's very interesting, that it has a very, very different feel to it. It's not that the CBC is pulling us apart. It does, of course, unify us, but it also unifies us in our differences.
Yes.
That there are intriguing aspects of community that you experience in Nova Scotia that you just don't see here. And I think that's the amazing thing. As you go across province by province, you actually hear different voices saying different things and focusing on different matters, and yet we're still the same. And I think that's it's a mysterious thing, but that's what this broadcasting company is able to do. I can still say what my favorite program is because you can still get it on the internet. Eclectic Circus was easily the best musical program that ever existed. I mean, there you go.
So the next question is, we no longer have Radio Canada International. I often listen to, I'm quoting the person who wrote this, I often listen to Radio Netherlands, Deutsche Welle, RTE Ireland, and to Radio Australia in the night. Canada is gone. What connection do Canadians living abroad have left to connect with their home? It's Patricia Hostick.
That was me.
I apologize. I should have put on these glasses, I would have done. So the first person on this cycle is you were first last time, weren't you, Marie?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, so the first person next time, this time is Paul Somerville, followed by Galloway.
I've been very lucky in my life to have traveled to and lived and studied in many countries, and I certainly was homesick that time in Alberta, and learned about Nova Scotia, and the things that connect Canadians. But I guess there were times when I was in Tokyo, and Jerusalem, and Geneva when I was even more homesick, and I listened to the BBC. To try to have a connection with what was happening in the world. It was hard in those times to find the CBC anywhere. The great thing about the internet now is that you can listen to CBC just about anywhere. But we're not telling our story without having an international thrust in what we're saying, how Canadians think about the world. So that's something we need to do. Thank you.
It is strange, isn't it, that as we develop outwards and become a global community, that the CBC is actually imploding and becoming much more located within Canada. And I think that that does suggest that there is a disjunction between how the government thinks and how they need to think in terms of our relations with other countries. I think that having Radio Canada International is a essential part of being a voice in today's world. I mean, in some sense, we are a United Nations, and we are a United Nations of voices. And to take away our voice is like closing the Libyan embassy or closing embassies in Canada. We need to actually keep contact with the outside world so that they know what we are thinking and they know what we are thinking. I think it's a crying shame.
I am a ham radio operator. A bit of a ham too. But we need to understand that CBC has a mission not only to Canadians, but to other people in the world. And on a 2-to-1 ratio, people listen more to shortwave than they do to FM or AM. And we need to expand that and make it possible for people all over the world who have tiny little shortwave radios to know about Canada as Canadians see it. And it is far less expensive, and it is far better understood. And it happens all around the world from one station. It can happen all the way. It can bounce around the world off the ionosphere. You know that. So why don't we use shortwave more? Thank you.
I also am a ham radio operator, bracket retired. And I miss the shortwave system. I miss Radio Canada International. I can say, though, I'm proud of the fact that CBC has tried its best to keep up with technology through the internet. My son lives in the United States, and he constantly will call me in the morning, because it's 3 hours difference on the East Coast, and tell me something he's heard on CBC. I think that's quite interesting. Podcasts are a thing that they've done very well, and you can listen to programs whenever it suits you. So the internet and podcasting technology, I salute CBC for trying to do. Lastly, I'll note Sirius Radio. I've been driving across the Baja in Mexico and had it tuned to CBC and listened in real time to things going on up here, and that's another thing that CBC has experimented with. I still miss the shortwave, but at least they're doing other things technologically to keep us in touch with each other.
I also am a ham radio operator. I wanted to VE3CSW,
okay.
The hate of Easterners.
VQC.
So I just wanted to say, if there are any other questions, and we still have a couple, but any other questions related to public broadcasting, now is the time to write them on a card. Otherwise, we're going to be talking about other subjects. Okay. So the next question is, it's not just a question of money. What should be done to improve the content of CBC radio that has deteriorated in recent years? Now, the first person in this cycle, the first person in this cycle is Paul Somerville.
Okay, so I'm going to take a little run at a national icon. Yeah, press the start button there. I don't want to over my time. I don't know if any of you have an iPad or a smartphone. If you Google Don Cherry Somerville, you can see what I've written about him. I actually think that they should fire Don Cherry. He's homophobic. He's anti-French. He's anti-immigrant. He's anti-women. He's anti just about everything. And he doesn't belong on the public broadcasting stage, in my view. And they really should have fired him when he embarrassed Canada and he embarrassed the CBC when he went on like a drunk uncle, goaded on by Ron McLean about why Canada wasn't joining the United States in an unjust and illegal war in Iraq. Thank you.
This is a really tough question, isn't it? I mean, what would you do to improve the content?
I just want to remind you that the question asked about CBC radio.
Radio.
Yes. I mean, I think that the interesting thing is that we don't hear enough voices within on CBC. I would suggest that, in fact, we have talent right across the country. We're overflowing with talented broadcasters who are not really broadcasters. I think to have debates, to have interchanges with individuals who are not the local, the usual suspects who are brought on for their, because we know what their opinions are going to be. There are many. We're an intricate multicultural society, and I think that we have to actually spend a lot of time ensuring that we get unique points of view. It's no coincidence that my favorite music program was Eclectic Circus, because I think eclecticism is actually at the heart of public broadcasting. We have to actually celebrate difference much more, and I think to get different voices in is the way to do that. Thank you.
A wise man once said, listen most carefully to what you do not want to hear. And that's what public broadcasting should do. It's to hear all the people that other people don't want to hear, like me. And this is censorship. This is a bias that's built into CBC, and nobody wants to recognize that. What should improve the content? A more objective way of assessing what they're broadcasting. And that is not being done with the people in CBC because it's incestuous. They appoint the people who appointed the people who appointed the people. And we've got to stop that. You want to hear from people like me, rascals, and all the people you don't want to hear. Listen most carefully to what you do not want to hear.
Okay. My little prescription, less American programming. The elephant in the room is all those programs that they put on the air from the United States and makes the TV universe look like it's just like the United States increasingly. As for radio, there seems to have been a great increase in repeat programming over the last while. Yeah. How many times do we have to listen to the same program? Yeah. I'd rather have them spend money to actually produce more programming. And I think that's pretty obvious. Next, I think we need to have more local-based programming so we can explain our own regions to each other. CBC does that so well. In parts of Canada, there is no other broadcaster, and I think that's really part of their mandate as well. Thank you.
Thank you for the additional questions that just rolled in. How serious is the threat of media concentration in Canada, and what does that mean for the role of the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation? Now, in this round, we start with John Galloway.
It's a very serious threat when you have a very small monopoly of companies that have control over opinion and media outlets. And it is because we are not going to get the full diversity of opinions. We are not going to have the full range of ideas, particularly when certain ideas usually elicit profit and others don't. That's the, again, I'm returning to the idea of the public good, that you cannot actually have a concentration of a few corporations basically running the ethos of our country. But that just is antithetical to what is right. The interesting antidote, though, is that with the development of the internet, we're now seeing exactly the opposite. We're seeing not a concentration of views, we're just seeing widespread views all over the place, different voices that... That's an interesting development.
So, you're second in this.
Truth and gravity always win. You can't suppress it. It comes out in the internet, Facebook, whatever you want. You can't suppress it. And even if you have a monopoly, you notice that things eke out anyhow. And I'm very glad for all the internet connections, because it does undermine the CBC. And in doing so, smartens them up. They don't represent Canada anymore. And so I'm not so worried about the concentration of the media being in the hands of a few, except the CBC, and that really does worry me. And I wish people would understand there is another point of view out there, people, that the CBC needs to hear, and this is such a good, bad example of it. Thank you.
How serious is media concentration? Very. Go to Vancouver. Seems like there's very few outlets that aren't owned by common interconnected corporations. I find that frightening. I also, looking at the Bell Astral deal that's in the news today, I think that's something we all have to be very much watch very, very carefully, and how the government reacts to that concentration. The point is, CBC provides the antidote to that. It's a place where balanced conversations can take place. Contrast that with the echo chamber, I call it, in the United States, where only people listening to Fox News have the same view of the world. They don't have balanced perspectives, they just have that one perspective. CBC has a statutory mandate to provide balanced perspective. I think it does a very good job. We need to fight for that.
Well, I'm probably the only person in this room to work for Lehman Brothers. Would that be right?
You're not a ham radio operator.
No, unfortunately. And I did fall into the liberal habit of taking credit for everything that was good that was done in the 20th century, which I apologize for. The reality is that when you wake up in the morning and you work for a firm like Lehman, or you work for a firm like Bell, or you work for a firm like RBC Dominion, you're just trying to make as much money in the shortest period of time as you possibly can and get as much of it for yourself. And that's why we need to have powerful government that regulates and tax large corporations so that they don't run roughshod over our society. And this is why a powerful and independent and well-funded public broadcaster like the CBC is so important to provide that platform to celebrate Canada, but also to celebrate diversity. Thank you.
Next question. if elected, will you commit to personally bring up protection of the CBC and secure funding in the House of Commons and make it your personal campaign, plus in a non-partisan way? And the person who put forward this question is a name well known to me, Vicky Husband.
Good for Vicky.
So number one here is you. That would be the headline for tonight. It's number one, according to the moderator.
What is the headline? No. I mean, who knows what's really going on there? And to make a personal commitment without knowing enough is foolish. And I don't know enough, and you don't know enough. I don't know who knows enough what's really going on in the CBC, except what people tell you or what they tell me. And isn't it strange that you have friends for CBC? You hear of any organization called enemies of CBC? Why not? Are you aware of dissent? Truth begins with little people, did you know that? And truth is never popular. And yes, there has to be another voice, two voices, three voices that are different. And no, I will not make this commitment because I don't know enough, and I don't know anybody who does.
I will make it my personal commitment to stand up for CBC. I believe that the issue of nonpartisan is problematic. I want to work with I see Vicky back there. I want to work with people on all sides of the House to reaffirm our commitment to public broadcasting that's viable in this country. Why am I hesitating? I'm hesitating to say this because of what some of the conservative members have been saying. I have in front of me seven statements from conservatives, each asking that we, quote, defund the CBC because it provides a, quote, unfair advantage over private sector competitors. And I just don't know how you can work with people whose view of the universe is so fundamentally different than mine. If I could reach out to those people, like Mr. Moore, perhaps, who I think is committed, I hope is committed, although his funding commitment certainly didn't bear that out, I would like to do so. It's a very good question. I want to make it work. I'm just concerned about what I read amongst conservative members.
Well, my first commitment in this campaign is to stop the billion-dollar boondoggle. But after I do that, here's my idea. And that is a private member's bill. No, I got an idea. In government in 2015. To give Canadians the option in their tax return to donate $500 as a tax deduction on their tax return. This would give Canadians a chance to express a voice and make a donation to the CBC. Thank you. Yes, you have my personal commitment that it will be a high, high, high priority. I will identify and promote the point of view expressed in Vision Green, the principled statement of the Green Party's position, identifying that over 3 years we need to devote $450 million at least, not taking into account recent cuts to the CBC. That's the position that the Green Party has taken. I think there is a hyper-partisan environment in Parliament at the moment. But I believe that as well as the Conservatives that Mr. Rankin is talking about, there are Conservatives who are just aching to get away from the top-down authority of Mr. Harper. I think that they have a voice and they can be bent. We can actually get a non-partisan body to support this, Conservative, Liberal, and NDP.
I just want to make sure that I'm not getting too lulled into something. Everybody spoke from that.
We did.
Here is a question. And this reminds me of something about Vancouver Island, but The question says, is there a place for French Radio Canada network from coast to coast? I remember a time when we wondered if there was a place for the English CBC network on Vancouver Island. So I'll just proceed then. Number one now is Murray Rankin.
Yes, there is. There is a place for French radio and TV coast to coast to coast. I certainly believe that's part of the Canadian reality, and they have linguistic rights to have the opportunity, what they call francophones and francophiles like me, who admire that broadcasting and that programming and have it available to us. As I said, one of my favorite parts of CBC is, in fact, Radio Canada's jazz programming, which I think is second to none. Yes. In terms of the question, made the comment about CBC coming to Victoria, it was only, if you can believe it, 1998 that we had an English language radio station here in Victoria, and I think that's a tragedy. We should have had it a lot earlier.
So after Murray is Paul.
Well, I echo Murray's comments about French language being available throughout the country. I mean, imagine the homesickness of someone in Alberta from somewhere in northern Quebec working in Fort McMurray, and maybe he had a bad moment in a bar. And goes home and just wants to feel that he's home for just a minute. And I think that's as important, maybe it's more important in this country, for someone whose first language, first memories, their soul is French, than maybe English speakers. And so I certainly support that. Thank you.
I would just, I think, echo what my colleagues have said. I think that language is an important part